Welcome to the flameworking tent here outside of the Museum of Glass. My name is Eric Goldschmidt. I run flameworking programs actually at the Corning Museum of Glass. And I'm also a gas board member, so very excited to introduce Chris here. So Chris Hurley has been an artist for the majority of his life, always drawn toward the creative side and starting early in his youth. Since finding glass in 1995, his focus has been on all things glass related. Initially working in the furnace, Chris began torch working shortly after. A quote here, "I love the independence of torch working. There's a sense of intimacy to the private environment which helps me connect with the medium. Through the quiet is where I hear the story that I like to reveal within my work." In 2000, Chris began working in a laboratory. Then thanks to scientific glass, he began to see the value of precision preparation, which he began applying to his personal work. "We would study each piece of prep to be certain of its purity before working the glass, where the laser passing through would not get hot enough to work in its final product." After a short hiatus in 2004, Chris took a workshop with Madness Cookie and was introduced to Venetian techniques in flameworking, which had a big impact. This was the first time since the furnace that the same tools and techniques were being used, but this time at the torch. This was so familiar that taking his personal work in the Venetian direction was a very natural transition. Today he credits the Venetian masters and scientific community for bringing his work into the realm it is today. So I'm quite certain we're going to see that sort of combination of some scientific-y concepts, and also I can see the tools there for some Venetian techniques. So I'm very excited to see Chris do his thing here. So let's welcome Chris Hurley.
You guys are too nice. Well, thank you so much for being here. I'm Chris Hurley, and I'm honored to demo for GAS. In 2008, I attended a GAS conference, and I feel like it changed the course of glass making for me. I was so inspired seeing these guys and the openness in this community. And so it's a real honor to be here. Thank you all. I'm a goblet maker, and I'm not prepared. Okay. I'm exploring some new things in my glass, so you'll see that it's taking a lot of work for me to do this. I'm making all my own Murrine, and it's a long process. So I'm about 7 or 8 days into what you'll see right now. And this is the last day. It's kind of the exciting day. It's the all pressure, all in day. You know, because you could lose all your work in just a second. And so, yeah, my nerves are pretty high because I usually do this in an environment where I have no distractions and I'm easily distracted. but I'm super excited to share this process with you. And I'm pretty quiet. I'll do a little bit of talking in the process of the making. And you guys can ask Eric questions. And Eric, you know, if you have some questions for me. Eric will understand the timing really well. I'm gonna stay kind of focused because I only have an hour and a half. Yeah, so I'm gonna get on with it. Wish we had a little more light. So the Murrine that I'm gonna use is really fun for me because it enables me to kind of tell a story. So the Murrine that I've made will show there are these tiny little buds, and all my pieces are kind of unique as I go. They're not really always repeated forms or concepts or colors. These Murrine are little buds, you know, and they kind of symbolize, much like I was in 2008, where I'm coming into this community, and I'm coming into my own just a hair, and but this community here is so inspiring. These are the buds right here. Yeah, you'll see that the Murrine making, it takes a day or 2 days each Murrine. I've gotten much faster recently, so I can actually, you know, start to do almost two of these images in 2 days, but I'm not quite that fast yet. So this one after the two little buds is two maybe more mature flowers that are nestling one of the small buds and growing this bud together. So I just like that symbolism of how, you know, our elders, they grow us, they support us, and the people around us. So this Murrine series is actually brand new for me, where I'm making these chips so that way they can be put together in a story like this. So the bush line is all around the same height, so as you can see, you know, they look like they're one and supposed to be together in the first place. I like to polish them up a little bit extra with the flame as I'm going along. Give them a little pinch and flatten them out. This chip is more colorful, and it's receiving kind of the effects of the community just being nurtured and grown. And I'm having a blast making Millie. I'm so inspired by all the other Millie makers that are out there.
That's so cool.
Everybody in the audience out here is one of my favorite Murrine makers.
Thank you, man. No, just playing.
I don't know, should I say his name? I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it right, but Matthew Brode is making some of the most beautiful stuff right now. I'm honored that he's even sitting here. I'm honored that all of you are here, actually. Thanks, you guys. So this one actually has a little ladybug in there that I put in there for luck. And basically stick them together, flatten them out a little bit, and then I roll them. Actually, I inspect them. Try to see which side is better to be facing out. Because I can put the bad side facing in, nobody will see it.
Only you know.
Yeah. It's like part of the thing with glassblowing is like how well can you hide what you where you've screwed up, where you learn from this business. Almost none of my work live, so this is interesting already. In so right, and kind of tip the ends in so there's no blurry side of the Murrine that you'll see. You can go ahead and take the whole trip. Yeah.
So over here,
if folks want to come by and take a closer look at some of Chris's Murrine work here.
I'm new, so go easy on me.
It's amazing, buddy. It's going to be scary when you're not new.
Oh, yeah. So it's kind of a square, but I like to try to pull it out, pull the sides out to a little bit more of a circle. Normally I would just foil pop this, but I've been adding these little leaves underneath before my coil pot, and it kind of makes my Murrine line vanish a little bit and kind of blend down into my tube. It gives it that extra little something different. It's been kind of cool. There is a safer way to do this, but I thought this would make for a fun demo. Yeah. Another way would make it maybe a little more crispy, but and for certain designs I think I would want to do that, but something I do a lot is I work in like the natural realm, and I think that these just look great, just organic, and whatever happens, happens. Me as well, where I'm doing the faceting and this kind of elaborate work where it's taking so long, and I'm really enjoying this challenge and the rush of putting this, you know, all this hard work together at the very end. Thank you. I only need a little bit of color, but it's, I find it's better to put a little bit extra on there. Because I need it. It's there. Basically, I'm going to do the same thing at the top, but what's really cool to me is I get to kind of make a little bit of a sunset. And lots of fun colors that I like to see in the sunset. I got some blues and some purples. Take it out before you even mess with it. Down with the good stuff. Add a little bit of blue. Kind of paint my horizon. A lot like I do the leaves. I think with the, you know, I don't want just a straight standard line. Which can be beautiful for some stuff, but with the sunset, I like to be a little more, I guess, free with the application. It is. Bundu, everybody. Love this guy. I probably learned that from you, Bundu. So, what he's saying, everybody who doesn't blow glass, is that the fire will come out where my finger is on the end of this tube, and the tube will get hot. And it gets a lot harder to fix. Yeah, I just take out these little lines. My work later will thank me. Right now, it seems like I don't have it yet. So I love this unevenness, and you'll see it in the end product where it just does something so cool. This is a beautiful color called Gold Ruby from a newer company that is making some really lovely colors, easy to work with.
What's the company?
It's called Molten Aura. You kind of have to buy their stuff as soon as you see it because they don't do big batches.
Yeah,
it'll kind of disappear in about 2 hours. Their entire nationwide inventory. Or whatever they make for people to go nationwide. Here, can you help me out with something?
Yep.
In that box behind me that has glass stuff in it, there should be a short section of tubing. At 32 millimeters by 2.8.
I'm sorry, what size?
32. It's only about, 3 inches long. This technique is called coil potting. I think it came from ceramics. That's it. Thank you, sir. Yeah, it's perfect. Thank you. Again, you just want to make sure you have at least enough, but I'm sure I have enough. Here's the screw. Kind of realizing I forgot some more things. Where you smooth out all your unevenness. Thank you. I use that for sizing my tubing, since I use that to slide over this and encase it. Sleeving technique is super cool, I think. Encasing everything that gets rough. And for people who don't look glass in the audience, this material has a lot of cadmium in it. And it wants to get really bumpy and show its pores. And something I just love about glass is how shiny it is. So I like to encase almost everything. I like to use a really thin wall, sometimes a 2-point wall or a 1.8 millimeter wall. But this one, I want a little bit of weight in here. I put a little extra weight at the bottom of my goblets so people can feel more confident about having them, so they're not too light. So this wall is a little bit thicker. Thank you. I'm doing right now is actually cleaning the tube. Like, it's pretty clean. I cleaned it before, but stuff can get into them, so thank you very much. So I like to burn everything out. And when burning it out, I have it open on both sides, so that impurity smoke can escape. And I can protect a little bit because it can get a little shocky. Technically medium, and sometimes I will put it into standard depending on my pattern, but this is for a foot for the bottom of my goblet, so I'm using a 2.8 for the extra weight. And I almost always use a medium wall. It moves really nice. So I'm just squeezing this new clear tube over the color and doing it slowly as to not trap any air. This step you actually don't want to go too fast because you will have to redo all your other work or suffer the air bubbles.
Do you ever encase under vacuum, or you prefer just gravity and pushing it around?
I think it depends on what I have to do.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. You know, if there's a lot of air in what I'm doing, mm-hmm. I'm probably going to use a vacuum and go extra slow.
Okay.
You know, but this is just a little surface one. My torch puts out a lot of heat, so I can just squish it on there.
Yeah.
I'm really liking the sunset that I did in here. It's actually really cool. I'm excited to show you that. Thank you. got to get the glass a little extra hot going over these cadmium areas.
Thank you.
trip that I'm trying to do now is have my roses at a certain level in my flare. So you have to place it, otherwise when I do my flare, it gets too flat. You have to look down to see it. I like for my pieces to be like a facing presentation. And you have to be careful not to twist these up, otherwise it looks like the wind's blowing too much. The cup that I'm matching it to, so it's good to have it nearby so you can get your proportions nice. You can see that if you like.
You can turn the camera.
This side.
No worries.
So you can see the horizon in there that I enjoy so much. And extra leaves.
Let me carry that around.
Yeah.
Okay, that seems like a better. She doesn't love it.
See how such things feel
on the way. Michael's going to take it away. So you can see the garden in there. It starts with the buds to the two adult flowers growing, a small one. There's a little ladybug on the final one that kind of makes me happy. So I would call this a fantasy cup, and that's why I flared that out like that. If I'm doing one for like a daily driver, you know, for people who are going to be using all the time, I'll tip the angle a little bit more specifically for the type of, you know, wine that they typically drink. But this is a fantasy, so I just think it's all about an aesthetic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Man, got the squirter over here
around the room.
Thanks, sir.
Puff it out at all when you're closing that end down where it goes from hollow to a solid avolio or whatever, or connection?
Right,
yeah, do you have to do anything to it to make sure that inner point doesn't do any weird tagging or anything?
You can't let it soak too long.
Okay.
Yeah, if you let it soak too long, it'll naturally have more heat and want to kind of collapse. And I guess I do put a hair of a puff in there so it doesn't have too sharp of a point.
Yeah, that's what I was getting at, like mechanical stress it could create at that transitional moment. But, you know, I mean, it doesn't seem like it'd be a big deal, but I was curious if you did anything to mitigate it.
You know, in a simple form like this, it's safer. There's times where that would be more critical.
Okay.
Yeah. I like to round out that wall right there since I'm going to be clearing it out in just a minute. So how even the wall is has a lot to do with how good your flare comes out. Where you size how much glass you're going to put in your flare. So you want to make sure to mesh out right. And that's why I didn't crimp it down so far right now, it's because it looks like I need a little bit more. Too much heat in there, and so I close this up and try to open it up. There it goes. Thank goodness. I normally don't close it down that much. It's called a lip wrap, and it's just a little color accent at the very end. And I, you know how like when you see a leaf in nature and it's got a little dampness to it, how it has that little glisten. So on my lip wraps, a lot of the times you'll see a lighter color at the end. I just like a little extra glisten. It's totally not necessary. It's just an aesthetic. So this is kind of long, but I do that on purpose to build more weight into it. It's a little thicker than the flare, which has its own, you know, pros and cons, but I personally think the pro of making the glass weighted so it doesn't fall over with all the attachments, I think it's worth it. It's real thick, so I'll switch over to these parchovies because it's heating up my jacks too much. This is all the thickening process. I'm actually moving the glass this way and down in to make it thicker. First timer.
Just glad to know you're breathing, buddy.
I am holding my breath. Forget that thing. Thank you. My punty is too short, so I'm burning the heck out of my hand. I'm trying to flare that up right to the roses, so it presents them off the ground. So you want to look for the shine, so kind of facing where the light source is coming in. Yeah, well, if there's any stress there, it gets a little fuzzy on the surface. And if you'd like to come up, I can show you there's a little bit on there. And so right where I was pushing it, right in there, you see how it's a little fuzzy?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And so sometimes it's avoidable, but when it's really thick, it happens a lot easier for me. And so I just like to go in there and tune it up. Than usual, but these last few pieces have led me to something I think is I'm kind of excited about, where it's got these marbles attached to the side that are full marbles. They've got these flowers in there. Let's see, huh? Hopefully you guys can all hear me. Okay. This right here, so I can just work off with my bench versus having everything in the kiln. The only stuff that I keep in the kiln is stuff that's really thick, because I can't heat it up too fast. It'll explode. And that's my foot. New sections that I'm going to put on there, these new flowers I was just telling you guys about. Okay.
Got this big dog.
Thank you, brother. No pressure, right?
Nah.
Just make it faster.
Yeah.
I'm gonna grab the car oil from inside, so I'll be back in 3 minutes.
Cool.
So this is, if you guys can all hear me well, this is the faceting on this section, and I have a love-dislike relationship with the faceting, because it is tough.
Challenge.
It is a neck breaker, and you know what I'm stoked about is that I put a little symbolism into everything, so. This has 50 faces because it's the 50th year of gas. So there's 50 cuts in here. The first angle is, I'm trying to remember actually. Let me get this on here. Yeah, this part actually gives me a ton of trouble. So this is where my nerves are at almost the most right now. You gotta get enough heat base in here to hold this thing on without breaking off, because it wants to break off so easy, I swear. But you don't wanna get too much heat in there that it polishes anything, any of your work. So the first angle on this is at angle of 21. I started blowing glass when I was 21. The second angle on it is 33. I'm a huge fan of borosilicate. It's a coefficient of expansion. It's 33. And the last one is 26. That's how many years I've been blowing glass. Yep. And I put that together with 50 faces of gas. And like I said earlier, gas has been a humongous influence, and so it was an honor to cut this up for gas. And it took a special index wheel that I bought. Hot connect. This is a gold connect, but I'm gonna do a full weld. Eric, is there any thicker rods?
Yeah, what do you need?
A 12 if you have it.
How about 8?
8's great, man. Sure. Thank you very much. Yes. Appreciate that.
Favorite spot, you know, either whatever my focal point is, if it's the buds or the main rows or the angle of the horizon, but I like that favorite spot to be the one that's going forward. And I'm gonna do the one that has the roses supporting each other. I think this is a community group. It's a little hot still. So because it's hot, I'm gonna warm up my claw. So, best way to go about it. I usually have everything cold. Or I just take a few more minutes and let this thing ramp down. Right now it's too hot, so I gotta let this cool down. This is actually the hard part, putting this together, so we're hoping for miracles. Find that the smaller claw has been better for me for the tops, and the bigger claw I like it on the bottom, and there's a lot of weight that I'll have on here in just a few minutes. And so the bigger claw, I can tighten it if it's heavier. So it's kind of got a double backup. All right. Usually working with a larger rod, so I've got to build this up a little bit. There's a little piece of dirt in there that I needed to take out. want to approach the bottom of this cup really slowly, or cautiously, I guess. Enough radiant heat to kind of pre-warm it. So I just want as close to the bottom of this cup as I can without heating it yet, because I just want to be very careful on that. Take off little segments. Can't remember out of the glass right now. Which one do I have in my hand? Which hand? Thank you. happy about that white color. I think it's looking really pretty. Give it a little twist so it's got the best presentation for the flower.
Looks like it's doing the dab, you know, the dance thing. It's like, yeah, whatever.
You know, I did some for a while that were like intended to be wedding sets, and they had like a conversation between the pieces.
Sure, sure.
There was like a couple either bickering or having a dance.
I gotcha. I just mean the bridges, to be clear, like little arms,
okay.
Not the piece itself.
The arms.
Yeah. I'm still at a loss as how they came up with something like that and called it a dab, you know? We already used that term, dogs. You can't recontextualize that shit.
So I like to put this thing down here in case I drop it. That weld down a little bit so it has a nice transition to the body. last thing. Yeah, this is the last thing. It's where I get even more nervous.
Thank you, man. All right.